All right. The first one, right? Yeah. Let's pick the mouse away. Hello. Let's get into it. Does it change? All right. Okay. So somebody was just talking outside about like, should I be using Python or Rust or something? So first of all, I want to define what Rust is about, what it's meant for. It's mainly for system programming. Your system programming languages typically are C, C++, and for the last many years also Go. And Rust is another in that family. It's mainly about safety. So unlike C and C++, which are extremely unsafe languages, and I'm of the opinion that you should not write new code in C++, especially C++. But the reason is safety. Safety is critical. Safety is critical in automotive. Safety is critical in web services. Safety is critical everywhere, almost. Why wouldn't you care about safety? And if you care about safety, you at least should consider a language that is designed for safety. And the difference with Go is that it's the Rust language also designed for speed. It's not just for safety, but it's also efficiency. So efficiency is a core concept in Rust. So if you want safety and efficiency at the same time, Rust is your language to go for. Also concurrency, Go does a very good job. I haven't coded in Go yet, but I'm going to in a month, a lot of it, I think. And this is a key concept in Go. So for people to come from the Go background, it's really important to attract them with providing concurrency in Rust. There is no concurrency in the language itself, but it provides a lot of good APIs to achieve the same, almost the same as Go. And it's an evolving area in Rust. There's a Rust library. In Rust, the libraries are called crates. And there's a crate called Futures. And then there's MIO, it's called, M-I-O something. And it's all about concurrency and async programming. One thing that I did not do in the beginning of my presentation, I think I missed that slide somehow, is my own introduction. So I'll do it now. My name is Ishan Ali. I work for Luxoft / Logicore. But I'm moving to Berlin soon to work for another company. I just couldn't handle automotive world. It's not for everybody. But if it's for you, it's good. But it just wasn't for me. So I'm leaving automotive behind soon. But currently, I'm still in automotive industry. What's wrong with C? As I said, it's not safe. Still, there are some things that you still need to do in C. You can't do them in Rust. For example, if you are doing kernel programming, it's not a really good idea right now to do it in Rust, even if it was possible.
Sorry to interrupt, but you can do it in Rust. You have something called unsafe Rust in Rust. So you can do
it. Yeah, but
you don't have the benefits of the type system in Rust. So you can violate the type system and do stuff if you want to, but then you're on your own.
No, I didn't mean that you can't do low-level stuff and unsafe stuff.
All right.
What I was saying was that you can't do kernel, like Linux kernel, for example. I don't know if there's any way of creating kernel modules in Rust right
idea.
Now.
You can do it.
Is there APIs and means to do it?
I mean, you can write in by assembly in Rust if you want to.
No, you can't. You don't have an assembly in Rust.
Yeah, you can. Unsafe Rust is another
language. You can say unsafe, but then you have
you don't have
XFI, and then you call to C. That I'll discuss
later. No, you don't call to C when you write inline assembly.
I know, but I'm saying that that's how what you do in, when you say unsafe, then you can, in those unsafe calls, then you can call to C.
Yeah, you can do that as well, but you can do inline assembly in pure Rust as well.
Who writes Linux kernel drivers in with assembly?
No, but I'm just saying you can do it in Rust. Because I have done it.
So you have written kernel modules in Rust?
No, I've written a kernel module for an embedded operating system. And then we use unsafe Rust to do some things with the type system. To for example, if you have a static buffer that you need to set a reference to or something like that, then you can do it in unsafe Rust.
So you wrote the module in Rust or C?
Rust.
Okay, and it was a Linux kernel module?
No, not a Linux kernel, but we did bare metal stuff in pure Rust.
No, I'm not denying that's possible. I'm talking about kernel program, Linux kernel program.
Yeah. But
so how, I was just giving an example.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, it's okay. What's wrong with C++? A lot. I won't go into that. But the main thing is that C++ has been very evolving language. Like, when you say C++, you don't mean one thing. You can mean lots of different incompatible things, because it has been changing so much in the last, I don't know, decades. Many times you will write something in like using latest C++, which is really, really good nowadays. Like, there's a lot of things in the latest C++ standard that makes it a really good language, but still it's effectively still unsafe. But it's not, because it's not designed for safety, so that's not difficult to imagine, understand. Java, yeah, many people like it, others hate it. I have never seen people not have a hard opinion, like a strong opinion about Java. Usually people do. But the main thing with it is the efficiency. And also, if I remember correctly, please correct me if I'm wrong, you can still do null pointer dereferencing in it, right? You can, right? Yeah. So that's another very unsafe thing to do, and in Rust that's not possible. What about Go? Well, if Go had everything that Rust needed, there wouldn't be any Rust. And even if it was, it would have been a very small project, because everyone would be using Go. And the main thing is it's not as efficient as Rust, because it has a garbage collector. And when you have a garbage collector, you will always have a performance penalty, no matter how efficient you make it. It's like, yeah. So, where pros, which are more like features, zero cost, they have a concept of zero cost abstractions. So, which basically means that when you have some, for example, a container, for example, a linked list or something, it will, the cost of it would be the same as it would be when you write it in C. So you don't have any performance, extra performance problems just because you wrote it in Rust.
Which were both space and time.
The thing is, it's a very general, I guess, question, but you do memory management yourself, which I'll get to later on, but it's not as low level as you do in C. You don't allocate things and stuff, but you still do some management. And because of that, you are generally very efficient. But of course, it's in the end up to you. If you want to allocate lots of GBs of memory for no reason, you can do it still. But you generally won't, because the language is not so that it will make you waste memory. It has a but there is a system called Cargo. It's a command. And that's basically, firstly, a build system for Rust. But at the same time, it's also a package manager. And by that, I mean you write your, it's like a make file. You declare your dependencies, and then it downloads those dependencies from GitHub for you, and compiles them for you, and the right version numbers. Also, like, it's, if you declare it like 0.8, so it will download the 0.8. And you can also say it like at least 0.8 or at most 0.8 or something like that for your dependencies, then it will do the right thing for you. So generally, when you have a Rust project, you usually download it, git clone it, and you just say cargo build, and that takes care of everything for you. You can even do cargo run, and it builds and runs it for you. So it's pretty nice. And also, it has built-in testing mechanism. When you actually create a new project with cargo, it will generate a test case for you, like a small one, so that you can put your test cases in there. And another cool thing is that when you document your APIs, and you put code samples in it, those code samples are turned automatically into a test case and then run for you when you do testing. It has a very powerful macrosystem. It was already powerful, like in the existing, the released versions, but there is a new one coming in the development Rust. It's already there and people are using it in the Rust Nightly compiler. And that that is just mind-blowingly powerful.
Macrosystem like in C or?
It's a lot more powerful than that. It's more like the Lisp macrosystem. So you can create new syntaxes, and the macrosystem will take care of that for you. It has good FFI. I had a very small example. So as one of that gentleman over there pointed out, it's you can declare unsafe code as unsafe. And the thing is that if you're calling out to C, you can't trust the Rust compiler has no idea whether it's safe or not. So the safe assumption is that it's unsafe. So you, if you call like that to C or something like that, like any unsafe code, you have to declare that code in unsafe. And then Rust compiler knows that, okay, this is the unsafe part. And it lets you do things that otherwise it won't let you. So you can bypass the safety when you need to, but generally you usually don't. That's our colleague who's weird. Alexander.
Robert Akin.
So anyway, I think you can kind of decipher this code a bit easily. It's just an external function we're calling from the C. We just get a number from there. And yeah. I won't go into detail. Did I miss something? Yeah. Now more the features.
Can I? Sorry, Susan. Can I make really stupid question?
No.
I guess. That will be. I guess that most of you are developers, extremely super great guys on that area. What about project manager who have actually C programming background like 15 years ago? Is there any chance to come back and start to think Rust as a expertise area? Is there something what that kind of profile have missed? If he have, of course, good knowledge about object-oriented software development and that kind of stuff. Is there something what you have already missed?
That I have missed.
Or that person have missed?
Yeah, I think so. I think, as I said, if you do programming that is about where safety and efficiency are both important concepts, then you should definitely at least look at Rust and see if you can, if it will be useful for you. And if it is, then yeah, use it. If it's not, then yeah, sure, you can use whichever tools you want.
But do you think it's kind of possible, based on those same type of requirements, which most likely have been there when that person have been doing C programming, for example? So performance, reliability, safety, that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Because that person is most likely C programmer. And that can...
Yeah, but the thing is that if he was a C programmer, he wasn't all about safety, right? Like safety wasn't that big a consideration.
Yeah.
So that would be an added bonus for that person.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
He's getting efficiency still. And still, and he gets a new bonus with his safety. Did I miss it? Yes. Yeah, stack by default. So you put everything on the stack by default. Of course, you can't program a lot if you only have the stack. So Rust does provide ways for you to, I would say, get around this barrier. But by default, everything is on stack. We'll look at it later. By default, your state is immutable. So in this code, for example, if you later on try to overwrite X, you can't do that. Rust will not compile. But in the later, the Y, you can compile. You can later change it, and that's fine because you have declared it mutable. And that makes it really easy to see which are your state, which is your state that changes and which is your state that never changes. So you don't have to worry about those if you have a problem. You can focus on the one that do mute it. It has strict ownership concepts. So at a time, a value can be owned by only one variable, for example. You can't have multiple owners of the same value. We will look at it a little later as well. I have code examples. Enums can have values, so it's a lot more powerful than the C enums, as you can see. So you can declare this one, for example, value, and then you can provide it integers and stuff. And you can even name the different fields. A bit like a struct inside an enum you can have, with a move one, more like a struct. You have pattern matching, which is combined with enums. It's very powerful, where you just use the keyword match, and then you give it something, and then it matches it with different things. It doesn't have to be an enum. You can, for example, match integers. You can match other things. But you can match strings, for example. And then you have different cases. It's a bit badly indented, I realize now. But they are all supposed to be on the same indentation level, the message. These ones.
Is identification important like Python?
Sorry?
Is it like Python? Identification is important to...
No, it's not.
Okay.
As you can also see, inside your matching, you can rename things. So the Y has been renamed to new name for Y, and then when we actually use it, we can use the new name for it.
Can I match inside those structures?
You can. They're full blocks. Like you can, like.
But I mean, in the matching directly, can I match change tower 0 GB?
I'm not sure I follow.
Yeah, can I make a match case where I change color and instead of R, I have a 0?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
You have something called traits, which is like interfaces in Java and those languages. So you have structures, and you can implement traits for them. There is some restrictions on when you can implement a trait for a particular structure, but I'm not going to go into details, but it suffices to say that it's to make things easy to follow, not like in C++ that you can't follow, like, this operator was overloaded for this type, but you don't know where and then where. So to keep that in check, there is some restrictions on it. You can search online about that. But I just wanted to show a quick example of trait. And there's implementation for circle, for has area trait. And as you can see, there's an implicit return output there. So in Rust, there's a difference between statements and expressions. So expressions can just be a return value on their own. You don't have to say explicitly return this. You can do that, it's not a problem. But then it would be a statement, and then it's an explicit one and return. Statements end with a semicolon, and expressions don't. So sometimes, many times you turn an expression into a statement by just putting a semicolon. There are some, of course, cons. It's still young. By young, I mean like 5-6 years old. I've been following it for many years. And the first time I started following it, I just couldn't compile anything in it because it was so unstable. But about 2 years ago, there was a 1.0 release. And since then, of course, it has been very stable. At least the 1.0-based releases have been on the same language. And they make sure that the code that compiled for 1.0 still compiles for 1.6 or whatever the main. I think it's 1.8 right now. I'm not sure. But I think not very young, but compared to like languages like C and C++ and stuff, it's extremely young. But then again, C++, you know, as I said, it changes. So it depends on which C++ you compare it to. ABI and stable. again, it's a problem if you are coming from C background, because in C you have stable ABIs, but in C++ you don't. So for a C++ background person, it's not a problem because
you can have stable ABIs in C++.
You do?
Qt does.
How?
For example,
you don't reorder stuff.
Yeah, but the thing is, that's the main reason Rust people didn't focus on it, because their main thing is C++. Coming from C++ background, they want to move from there, and they said, oh, since C++ doesn't have stable ABI, we don't need to care too much about this right now.
C++ does. I mean, Qt does. If you do a revision change, you have the major and minor revision, you don't have ABI breakage. Or I don't. Or you don't have any breakage at all, no. And then you
because
can...
Because I've been told that's the case. Like, I'm not a C++ guy, but I've been told by C++ guys and Rust guys both that this is the case. So
KDE and Qt have very strict rules about what you're allowed to do between versions to keep the ABIs, but it is possible. It might be cumbersome, and you might be able to shoot yourself in the foot if you do advanced templates and stuff, but it is possible.
Okay.
Can I recommend a talk by Thiago Macier on this topic, how to write libraries that keep binary compatibility.
But you could argue that the ABI between different C++ versions hasn't always been stable. C++ 11 and C++ 98 are not completely compatible.
I don't think your ABI is stable between compiler versions either.
No,
or,
you are. You are. You don't need to recompile just because you change compiler.
We need to ask Thiago. I'm not into the
anyway,
details. But you can do take steps to actually stay ABI compatible within certain parameters.
Okay.
For
C++. Well, of course, yeah.
Yeah.
No
arguments.
Memory management for Rust. Since I was introducing to Rust anyway, I thought like I'll give you a very short introduction, because the reason is that if you all go now and start typing Rust code and want to try it out and stuff, you will be very angry at me. You will be like, why did Zishan tell us to do this, wasting our time? Because you will not be able to compile code for a week, because if you haven't conquered the memory management, you can't code in. But once you conquer the core concept of memory management, you are good. You can go ahead and you can compile your code and you'll be very happy. And the thing with Rust is that once you get your code compiled, it usually works as you plan. And it's a really good feeling. Like, I've never had this feeling because I was a C programmer. You course compile something, you say, oh, I got it compiled. Should I run it? Nah, I think I'm going to go home today and tomorrow morning I'll try it. Because you know that in runtime it will fail in spectacular ways. But in Rust, that wasn't the case. Each time I compiled, it just worked. So, yeah, memory management. I want to show you some code. Can you see it by any chance? I'll change font size or try it. I did succeed very well. Okay. Is that good?
Yeah.
Yep.
Okay. So it's a very simple call. You make a function at first element. You pass it to vectors, two vectors. And what it does is just adds the first two elements of the vectors and then returns. This code you will expect to be able to compile, right? Because then you declare two vectors in two variables, pass them on, and then the answer comes. It should be able to print it, right? But let's see what actually happens. You get an error. It tells you that you have already used a value and you have moved it, and it tells you where you moved it. And then it doesn't let you use it. The reason is, as I said before, Rust has strict ownership semantics. So when you pass a value to a function, you're passing the ownership to that function. And then since that function got the ownership, and it never returned the ownership back to you, you're no longer the owner of that value. And that's why this doesn't compile.
It's not a noisy program like hell at the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. I was like, what do you want from me?
Well, I mean, if it's immutable by default, would that matter really? If the values were variable?
No, it has it's nothing to do with being immutable. It's more to do with that you have only one owner or value at a time.
But so ownership of a constant value.
But is it that you pass arguments as references, always?
Well, I'm getting there.
Yeah, okay, sorry.
So the way you do it is there are multiple ways, actually. So there's the same example, as you can see, but except that this time there's something called borrowing involved. And borrowing just is references. So you accept references, and that's it. And the reason it's called borrowing is that you borrow the ownership of something you have ownership of, and then that's it. When the borrow is finished, you are no longer borrowing it anymore, and then you have the ownership back. You seem confused.
No, what is the first use case of not borrowing it, basically? If you call a function, isn't that the main purpose usually?
Yeah, but you're passing by value,
right?
And you're passing the ownership of that value then.
Okay.
And that's why it doesn't. It's a side effect of not of having strict ownership semantics that
right.
you have only just one owner at a time. Yes.
What's the point of like this feature of language that you eventually want to bypass? Like you said that like this
no, it's not exactly bypassing. It's working around it.
Yeah, but,
no, but it's in a safe way. But the thing is that if you were allowed all these things, you can mute it, you can do all those things like without all those the methods. So the methods make it a safer, it provides you a safer way of doing the same.
But what do the designer of the language thought when they think about the concept of ownership? Like why they designed the language in this way? What was their purpose? I'm not saying that what you did is wrong or anything. I don't understand why they did it as a default statement. What do we get?
Actually, the thing is, if these were integers,
mm-hmm.
the V1 and V2, this would not be a problem. If you had the error that I showed you, it actually said that does not implement copy trait, the vector. So the simple types implement a trait called copy, which means that when you pass it on, they get copied to the function, and then there's no problem. So usually for the simple types, you have, it's the same as, but it's for complex types, for things that allocate stuff on the heap and stuff, that you need to have one order at a time. Well, in case of integers, it's true as well, but in that case, it gets copied. So you don't have the same integers as different values.
Would this help with when you try to do concurrent programming, like not having two?
Oh, I'm getting to that.
Yeah,
maybe that was my answer.
Yeah.
Okay, for concurrent
or
okay.
SP.
Yeah, I'll get to that. But the first thing is we can turn these simple parameters into references, and then you get borrowing, and then everything is good. Make sample two. This one compiles. And it runs. Copy types, as I mentioned, they are basic types that just get copied, so it's not a problem. And you can implement for your own types copying as well, it's not a problem. And then,
but if you want to copy a vector, do you sort of have to do a
a
method call saying that I want to clone this one and pass?
No, but you will be implementing it, so you will.
So you will have to borrow it into a function where you explicitly copy it and sort of return the copy as the result to generate a second instance of that vector, or how do you?
So you mean? Are you asking how do you copy a vector?
Yeah.
There's an API for it.
Yeah, so, you,
so it says...
but you explicitly have to say that I want a copy of this one.
Yeah.
And pass it along.
Yeah, you can do that.
Yep.
But also, I guess it's a proactive safety, because then you have to implement the copy thingy for your own types, and by that you cannot mess up, as you can in C++, for example.
Yeah.
Or you can pass objects by value, and you think it's okay, but it's not, because it's a promoted function. But here you're stopped in right away, so you're forced to.
The only problem with borrows is that it's temporary. So if someone wants, like you pass to a function and it wants to keep it in a struct or something, you can't do that. So for that, for those we have other container types that follow it, and actually they are called smart pointers, pointer types as well, because they are basically smart pointers. So here's an example. It's a struct, like just it says a registration, it's supposed to be a helicopter. And then we have methods on that struct. The first one is simple, we pass it a string that becomes its registration type, and then it returns a heli, it's just a constructor. And the second one is hover, and that takes reference to self, and this shows it. Anyways, I guess you guys can follow it. You would normally expect it to just work, right? But I don't think it will.
I don't think so either. You wrote it.
There you go. So as you can see, the reg that we passed, we later reuse it, although we have already passed it to the struct constructor, and the constructor put it in the struct. So, and it's not a copy type, string is not a copy type, so it doesn't automatically just get copied. So because of that, we have something called RC. That's one of the smart pointer types or container types. It stands for reference counting. So if you want to have multiple owner of the same data, that's what you need to use. This type ensures that there is no weird shit going on, so you can have multiple copies of it. And since it's reference counted, so as soon as it goes out of scope and all everywhere it's being used, it automatically gets freed.
Can you still reference it, sort of create a circle of reference? So you have a reference counted container that contains itself and sort of fuck up that way?
Because no, you can't fuck it up.
But you will leak memory in that case.
You mean a reference count
if you have
RC in an RC?
Yeah, an RC in an RC pointing to itself.
Oh, to itself?
Yeah, so then the reference count will never go to zero.
Well, how would it...
If you have a list of lists and you put
the
first
like
list
that,
inside
yeah.
the... Can you do
I
that,
think,
or does it detect the circle of dependencies?
I think there's an error from Rust about like when you have those recur... Because we will later see one place where I try to do recursive thing and then it doesn't let me. So...
Yep.
And all this allocation is on the stack, right?
Yeah, by default it, everything goes on the stack. But then from inside those construct, they can put things on the heap. So I think RC is putting the actual value on the heap. We will discuss it a bit later.
Before we go further, I mean, I didn't understand the purpose of this sample. I mean, what was the difference between sample 2 and sample 1? Why did you put... I didn't understand why you bring a new... I mean, why did you use sample 2 for the previous question?
It's about borrowing. So the thing is that now we are putting in a struct. And it's still living there. So like previously it was a function call, and the function call returned. So the reference, we don't use the reference anymore. So it's gone, borrowing is gone. But now we are putting in a struct.
I mean for a struct is
and,
also
in
a second.
Yeah.
I see, sorry.
No worries. So this time we're using RC. So the only difference is that now registration is inside an RC. And then we go RC string. Another difference is that you create a registration, you put that string in RC new, and then you have it in RC. And there's something called clone. So each time you want to create a new copy of the, or I would say reference of the RC, then you just call clone and you get a new one. So I'm giving it a new reference of the reg, and then the struct can keep that one, and then later on I use the other one that I already want.
So clone is not a deep copy, it's just the creation of a new reference.
Yeah, it's a new reference only. So this one compiled, and as you can see, it works.
This control of ownership, you get like an implicit scoping of the variables, more or less.
So now we introduce threads. It's the same thing, but just this time using threads. So I'm still using RC, reference counting, and then I tell the thread to spawn. And from the Rust has closures, so from the closure you call it ali.hover. And basically the same, just the thread in old mode. You would expect this to work, right?
No.
Not the third time around.
Not anymore.
We
trust you, Susan, at some point, but not anymore.
Every
example is failing first, and then you will fix that.
Yeah. So now the problem is that RC, it's a reference counter. It makes sure that there is at a time like it just gives you new references to the same data, but it doesn't do any multi-threading. It doesn't know how to lock things, and so it won't let you use the same RC from different thread. It won't let you use any data from the other thread unless it implements some tricks that are called send and some other thing. I don't know about the naming. It's weird, but. Anyway, it won't let you do unsafe things like that. So what we need is...
So threading is built into the language then, I guess.
Yeah, threading is. So, and then you have arc type, which is the same as RC, but atomic. So that's all it means, atomic reference counting. And that means that at a time, only one thread can access it. Look at the code. So you see the same example, same threading, but this time we are using arc instead of RC. So just like RC, you are using most of it is the same. Or is it exactly the same except? Yeah, it's exactly the same except RC is replaced by arc, and now you can use it from that.
So no need for mutex or anything, basically.
Not right now, because we are not modifying it.
Right. Oh.
But you have to put the arc into the heli object. So you have to sort of the class has to be adapted to be used across multiple threads rather than.
Yeah, it depends on it's a usage that needs to be adapted. So if it's a struct that's using it, then it's a struct that needs to be modified. But one thing you would see that it's not a string, and I have used it like just as if it was still just a string, not inside arc. And there's a reason for that. Rust is has something called dereference trait, and many of the standard types they implement that. And because of that, Rust is given information to automatically cast it into a type that is needed. So for arc, it automatically dereferences into into the string it contains. So you don't have to always say use some keyword or something that I want the data inside you. It is automatically done for you.
That move thing you have in there.
I was hoping nobody asked for that. it's basically more a copy. So when you say move in front of what do you call it?
Closure.
Bias?
Yeah, it's a closure.
No, it's a more...
Lambda.
Lambda, yes. So, more beer for this guy. And lambda, if you say move, then it takes copies of the data that is being used inside. So, for example, this heli. So, you're using heli. So, it will take a that heli inside the closure room. That takes the ownership. But for copy types, it copies. So move is a bit misleading because for copy types it will copy and stuff.
So we can't use heli below?
I don't think so, no.
So you will have some data on both the threads, the stacks.
Sorry? Like
this heli or whatever,
yeah.
That will be on the first, the main threads stack, and then it will be on the spawn
yeah.
threads stack as well, right?
Yeah. But though also, if you notice, it's more like you're not actually using heli as per se. Compiler knows that you are actually calling this method of heli, and that one takes a reference. So it's not like you're passing ownership. So because of that reason, I don't think it will transfer ownership of it, because you're not using ownership.
So it's hiding, not giving away.
Sorry?
So it's hiding the fact that it's not giving away the ownership.
You mean a move?
Yeah.
No. It's another topic, I guess. But anyway, you have an arc, and this one should work, I think. Yeah, it's working. That's what I can tell. Then you have sample 7, which someone will just ask about. Right. So we have again thread, we have again arc, and now we have added one more thing called status, which is also a string in an arc. And it's pretty similar, except that this time we are actually changing something, which is the status one. So when each time it hovers, we update the status. And that's just that we push a string into it. So let's see how that goes. If you can see, I have declared this mutable, heli, but I haven't declared status mutable. The reason is that mutability is applied on the use, not the declaration. So you don't need to declare things as mutable. If you declare when you declare the variable, when you create the ownership of it, if you declare that mutable, that value is mutable. If you want field level mutability, there is a special container called cell. It's a bit like arc, but it's called cell, and you put it inside that cell, and then that makes it possible to have mutability declared in the declaration in the field level. So you can have like heli won't be mutable, and you can have the status inside a cell, and then you can just modify the status itself in the heli, although the heli is not mutable. So you can only, yeah. Where was I?
So
what's the problem with this? It's mutability. Let's see how it comes up. It doesn't work because we are mutating it, and all we have is atomic reference counting. We can have multiple owners of this, like we can access it for multiple threads, but we can't modify it. For that, we have another concept called mutex. Just like many languages, you have mutex, so in Rust you have exactly the same. And you can, if you put something inside a mutex, you can have get locks on it, and then you can modify it within that lock. And since objects and structures that the values they go automatically get freed when they go out of scope, you don't have to unlock mutex. And usually you put it in an arc because you want to access it. You want atomic references on the mutex. Is it sample 8 now? So this one should work because it uses mutex. So I put, it's just that status is now not just in an arc but also mutex. And all that I do is I get a lock on it. Unwrap is a way to get rid of errors. Usually unwrap is bad. You should never use unwrap in your code. I'm just doing it for demo purposes, because then I'll have to handle the error explicitly. Otherwise, Rust will complain that you're not doing that. So you lock it, and once you lock it, you get a value, which is the actual thing that you inside it. And then you just use it like you were previously. That's mostly it. That's the only difference. In here also, it's like mutex instead of an arc. And the rest of this thing is the same. But also, main thread has to also do the lock it when it accesses it. Yeah. This one would compile.
Does it get unlocked automatically when it exits the function?
Yes, not the function actually, I'll show you. But more like the scope. So in this case, the function is the scope.
Okay.
So when it comes to this point, the lock will be unlocked automatically for you.
Okay,
because the type that you get from the lock function, that is automatically dereferenced into the exact type that you need. That one takes care of unlocking for you. Because when it goes out of scope, when it gets freed, then it unlocks mutex for you.
What about in main? When is it unlocked?
Well, it's the same in here. When the function goes out, you can also explicitly create blocks to make sure that things get freed and unlocked exactly when you want them.
So, because if it does that, then in your original code, you can, if the main function gets the lock first, you get the,
No, but there was no mutex then, so there was no locking.
No, in the original version of this one, before you choose modify.
You mean, like this?
Yeah, so if the main function gets the lock first, and it then wait for the trade to finish, then you can get into a deadlock situation.
Yeah, but it's already spawned and like it will be done. Like it's a synchronous code, so at some point that doesn't matter which one takes the lock first. Like that, if you're saying that if this locks happen before this lock.
Yeah.
So let's assume like this happened first.
Yes.
And you printed this function printed.
Yeah.
And then you went to the t.join and you're waiting for the thread to finish, and the thread will not finish until they execute this part.
So the trade cannot get the lock because main.
It has. Oh yeah, I see your point. Yeah, that's a trouble in there.
And it doesn't, it still compiles.
That's
an intelligent question.
Was the synchronous when you launched hover? Can't be, I guess.
Which is synchronous?
No, when you're launching hover, I guess it was directly.
No, it's a thread, so
yeah, exactly.
You can't assume anything about it.
So if you put a sleep or something in hover, let's see what happens.
But the value you lock inside the print time, it doesn't go out of scope when you're in the print time. I mean, you don't have a variable.
Yeah, no. But the thing is, that's the way it works. Like, things get dropped out when the scope is finished.
Yeah, but what is
the But
scope
the scope is the print line.
But if you
the scope in here is the main function.
But if you
isn't it the print line?
It's not inside the scope inside the port.
Yeah, that's what I was doing. Like when I modified it, I put a scope around it. So then it would work,
no,
but currently
yeah,
it would not.
The call itself could be a scope, since you don't have a variable assigned to the value status.lock.
Yeah, but it's not a script, that's what I'm saying. It could be, but it's not. So, I'm stumped. How awesome.
Yeah, but I think if you declare mute self in hover, I think it should solve it, because when you have self, it's it's the value is immutable, then you can have several entities using it, and then when you have it at mute, only one can execute that function at a time. So this has something to do with the concurrency in Rust built in by compile time. So for example, you can have several parties borrowing a value if it's immutable, but you can't do it if they are mutable.
No, but as we saw before from the errors, that's not the case. You can't have multiple ownerships of the same value.
Yeah, but you're borrowing here. Self is a borrow.
Yeah, it is.
So I'm not sure, but that's just my...
No, I know it. Like it's borrowing, but I don't understand how...
I mean the borrowing, you can borrow mutable or immutable.
Yeah, but if I borrow mutable, why would that change anything?
Because the Rust compiler tracks it.
Yeah, but what has that to do with the concurrency problem?
Yeah, it solves the concurrency problem at compile time, because when you have declared it as mutable, only one entity can access that at the time.
No, that's not true.
Yeah, that's true.
I don't think so.
Yeah, but try it out.
Like
but
how?
But try it out.
Like this?
Mute.
Yeah?
Yeah, I think it's...
And
yeah, I see the point. If you have a variable that is lent mutable to any party, no one else can borrow it because the one you borrowed or lent to mutable can actually change it, so the other parties can end up with a value that has somehow changed. I think that's your point.
Yeah, so you can see it as shared or not shared. If you want to, immutable. I think that's the case. But
mute just makes it mutable, it doesn't make it shareable.
Yeah, but it's the same in Rust. I'm pretty sure of it. But.
I don't think so. But let's try it.
Ask the compiler.
Make it mute. And then what?
Yeah, you should get compile time
error.
Yeah, you should get compile time error, but we are not trying to get a compile time error. We are trying to solve the problem.
Yeah, but all right, I leave it. You should.
Don't.
Anyway, I was getting to read right now. So that was the normal lock. Mutex is a normal lock. So multiple threads try to get a lock, and only one of the thread gets a lock at a particular time. Not many of them. But with a read-write lock, as you know from other languages, there could be multiple readers getting a lock. But if you want a writable lock, if your main thread is taking a writable lock, then that's the only lock there will be at the time. So sometimes you need that, and that's very efficient. So if you can use read-write lock, that's good. There's one more thing. It's called a box. This code just demos like basic usage of it, but it's completely useless. Like, why would you do this? But the main thing is box is the easiest way to put a value on the heap. As I said, everything goes on a stack by default. So, but if for some reason you need something on the heap, box is the simplest way to do that. It doesn't have reference counting. It doesn't have all the other things that other types have. But at least you could put it on the heap. But there's one usage of it. That is size. So sometimes you need to know the size of the values from the beginning, from the compile time. Compiler needs to know. And you don't always have that. And I'll give an example of what type. For example, in this case, you want a type that is a list, and that can contain other lists. It's like in list, you have concept of cons. And this one is also again a list. So this, if you try to compile this, it will end in error because compiler doesn't know how much memory to assign for enum, for this enum, because the list is part of it. It's not a reference to a list, but it's list itself. So an easy way to work around this is to make it a box. So it will become kind of like a pointer, but actually it will become a pointer. And it doesn't need to hold list itself in a list. but more like a pointer to a list. And yeah, you solve the problem. So there are these kind of problems where you need to have a reference just for that, and you want thing to be on the heap, and you use Box for that. That is all, and if you are looking for work related to Rust and stuff, visit this page. You can find it on online. Just search for Friends of Rust, and you will get to this page, which has a lot of companies listed on it that do Rust programming. Talking of which, there's Pelagicore. I have created an interest in that. I don't know how far will that go when I leave, but hopefully it will go somewhere. So they might be interested in working on it. You can talk to them if you are interested in working at all in automotive and Pelagicore, and they can tell you if they can let you code in Rust or not. There's other companies, like there's companies on, especially on the West Coast, there's a lot of startups there, and there's also startups in Berlin, I think, a lot of them that are extensively using Rust. Some of them are trying it out, some of them are just like they just want them straight with it, and they're not coding anything but coding Rust. So, yeah. Is it too good? Or can I go now?